Okay, so we'll get started here. Big picture, we're going to have Marianne Bobskill talk to a little bit of past work that's been done. Andy Spry from Planetary Protection will say a few words, since obviously that's a key topic as we go forward, and we'll kind of even let a little bit of a Q&A go on that, since that's such an important topic for both of these areas. Then we're going to talk about this prototyping idea and making sure everybody understands that goal and what we're trying to do there. And then what we're going to do is, you got a copy of the, Ben sort of led essentially a brainstorming session this morning, which is great, but we want to systematically go through the questions that we gave everybody to make sure we didn't miss anything. And if you don't have any, oh, I forgot, so we can get those covered. And then we'll pretty much be done. So we'll start with Marianne, then Andy Spry, and then we'll talk about prototyping again, and then we'll go through the feedback, the sort of more formal feedback questions, and then we'll get everyone on their way. And thank you.
Okay.
All right, are you ready?
Yeah.
Is this working?
Okay. And Android.
We'll give you a little. I'm Marianne Bobskill from NASA Langley. I'm on the human spaceflight architecture team, HAT, that you've heard of, and also we're supporting the Evolvable Mars campaign. And Steve Hoffman and I are going to kind of tag team here. We're going to talk basically about reference sites, so I'm going to set it up, and then giving you some background about a case study that we did to kind of get smarter on this kind of stuff. And then Steve's going to talk about going forward, what kinds of analyses, mission analyses we'd like to do. I just want to note that within the EMC, within HAT EMC, we have a number of teams. One of them is the Mars Surface Team. We have transportation analysis team, we have on-orbit teams, propulsion teams, lander teams, and we, Larry and Steve, manage the EMC Mars Surface Team. So the work that I'm going to talk about was done by that team collectively. We did this study in 2013, so it's not too old, and it's the final report is like 300 plus pages. We put together a shorter public version that's about 200 pages. I don't know what to say, I'm sorry. And you can get that. You can access that. It's on the NASA.gov site right here if you'd like the more detail. I took that 200 pages last night, not with a six-pack, but with a glass of Chardonnay, and brought it down to about 20 pages. So here's hoping that that works. So I'm going to zip through, hopefully, the first set of charts to kind of lay the groundwork in it, so we can get to the good stuff, and that is the actual mission that we analyzed. So let me zip through this. We were asked as a team to spend the year and devote our time to developing what we call a point of departure concept of operations, CONOPS, specifically for a crewed Mars surface mission, long stay mission. So in this case, it was a 500-day mission on the surface, and to have it be science driven so we could start to understand and educate ourselves regarding all the issues, all the kinds of activities that the science group would want to do. So our first issue, then, we did not have access to an esteemed group as this sort. We had to kick it off and get started. So our first question was, where do we get the relevant science information from? And so we began with a MEPAG report that existed at the time, the HEMSAG, Human Exploration of Mars Science Analysis Group, and reviewed their document, and that was basically our foundation document for understanding the science types of activities to be done. Just to note that in that document, geology, geophysics, atmospheric and climate science, and astrobiology teams were formed, and objectives and all science objectives and activities and all were developed for those. In addition, then, we contacted a number of the people who actually were on the HEMSAG teams, and in a minute you'll see who was actually on our team, and a number of you who are in here actually helped us as well on the team. And they helped us throughout and answered questions and helped us understand what was in here in the HEMSAG document. We also created a workbook. to kind of provide a mechanism and formalize a method for collecting information and more details about the types of science activities that the folks who developed this would like us to do. Here it is in small form. Of course, it was an Excel spreadsheet. And here's the kinds of questions we asked of everyone. We asked them things like, do you want samples? How many samples? How pristine do they have to be? Can the crew touch them? What kind of place would you like data analysis actually done? Where do you prefer this? Do you want to collect a sample from subsurface? Things of that sort. How many samples have to be collected? How many samples have to be returned? How clean do they have to be? What kind of precursor measurements are required? We asked a lot of information of these folks, and they completed this. And then we reviewed that and held basically interviews with the folks on the HEMSAG science team who filled this out for us. In addition, we hosted a series of subject matter expert briefings, primarily on three broad topics. We wanted to start diving deeper on some of these. Here are the folks who actually briefed us on these. The astrobiology folks said they wanted to talk to us about the possibility of subsurface samples and doing deep drilling on Mars. We wanted to start getting a little more knowledgeable about what is involved in doing deep drilling. So we brought in some of the experts on that from the Department of Energy who do deep drilling and developing drilling technologies on Earth to talk to us about what it would take to be able to do that on Mars. We also wanted to know a little bit more about biocontainment of potential pathogens. We have Dr. Kate Rubens, who's not only in the astronaut office, but she's also a molecular biologist, and she's worked in BSL-4 types of laboratories and facilities. So she came in and briefed us and answered our questions and was on call regarding those things. In addition, we realized we needed to start getting smarter on planetary protection and its impact on crew surface operations. We'd already reviewed a lot of NASA documentation on that and Coast Guard documentation. So we got in touch with Cassie Connolly, the Planetary Protection Officer, and she actually briefed us a number of times over several hours about planetary protection levels and issues and concerns regarding samples. And then in addition, she has a number of folks who are planetary protection folks on her team, and she assigned them to work with us. So you'll see in a second that they're on the team. We also did a number of other things. We held an educational forum. This was above and beyond the science part, per se. But we wanted to know more about issues that relate to being able to do science activities on the surface. So we brought in the EVA folks and the suit port folks. If you got to see the rover model that was out there, there are suit ports in the back. There's a real important reason for why we want to do things like that. And they really help the crew be able to quickly jump into the suits, unhook, get out, and do 15 minutes of EVA quickly, come grab a sample, take some good pictures, come back in again. So we wanted to find out more about issues regarding EVA and suit ports. We wanted to understand about crew medical issues, crew safety, sample handling, and planetary protection. We also defined a set of what we call guiding questions, and this information was provided to the participants in this to get them thinking in these ways and then get them to help provide that information to us. We asked about things like crew waste storage and transfer, pressurized cabin operations, and sample handling on the surface. We also went down to JSC and toured the sample curation laboratories there. Thank you very much, Mary Sue. It was a very interesting tour there to see how in clean rooms they handle incoming samples and just to kind of help us understand this process better. And then we also did a series of what we called special studies. Through the whole process of doing this year-long case study of a Mars surface mission, there were a couple of points in that were of particular importance, and so we assigned a small study team and did a deep dive on that. So we looked at things like Mars laboratory and sample handling, integrated drilling, surface, et cetera. This was our team. This was our primary leadership team on the core membership. There are a whole set of people behind that here and all of the DOT support across the entire agency. They work with us regularly, and they're specialists in these particular areas. And then in addition, we had a set of science discipline folks and discipline leads that we could go to, and then they had folks who worked for them that they also went to. So we tried very hard to do our homework and bring in early on as many people as we could to keep us on the right path. So, getting into the actual study itself, in the HEMSAG, you may recall that the teams identified 58 candidate Mars landing sites. And they were kind of ranked, I put that in quotes. But of these, there were four candidate sites kind of at the top of the list. We selected those four sites, dove in and did some more analysis of those, and then decided to begin with looking at Santorini Montes. I was going to point to it here, but the Mars picture is gone. It's in the southern hemisphere east near Hellas Basin. We chose that not because it's the most wonderful site, but because of a couple reasons. One, it turned out to be one of the sites of the list of 58 in the HEMSAG report where all of the science disciplines wanted to go there. So it seemed pretty good, you know, pretty obvious to us that there were a number of potential activities, science activities that could be done, of interest that could be done at this one site. In addition, the folks on the HEMSAG teams dove into Santorini Montes quite a bit, and they all actually provided some predicted traverse paths and more information about this site that would actually get kickstart us. So we chose that site, and then we made a set of assumptions. There's a whole bunch of information behind these. We don't have time to go into it, but keep in mind for this particular case study that we had a centrally located habitat. It has volume and resources allocated specifically for science, so there will be some science labs within that. For example, we assume two pressurized rovers that would be used for the long-range traverses for the field work. They would have potentially basic analytical equipment in them, handheld stuff, and all the tools you need to do field work. It's up to you to help us understand what that means. But we have a mass allocation and volume allocation for it. Two unpressurized rovers that would work within a walkback distance. We assume robotic support and low latency telerobotic operations. What that means is you have a crew that's right there in situ with potentially a number of robotic support elements, and it behooves us to use them to the greatest extent possible, and hopefully to be able to use them from IVA, whether it's on the surface of Mars or in Mars orbit or on Phobos, for example. So we are looking into low latency telerobotics. One little example of that is if you want to get a pristine sample, subsurface sample for astrobiology, for example, and you might be able to teleoperate a robotic, a sterile robot on the surface prior to the crew even coming down, right? Get that subsurface sample, contain it safely, and then bring your crew down. And then once the crew is on the surface, you might want to consider doing something like allowing the crew to be inside the habitat and operating teleoperating some type of robotic device. We assumed samples would be returned to the primary habitat, and we started thinking about what it would take to be able to do that. We looked at drilling. We're assuming nuclear power system based at the habitat, as you've already heard, ISRU. Here's a really interesting one. We've made estimates within the Evolvable Mars campaign, within our lander team, about the amount of predicted down mass and then how to allocate that and partition that. And we have regularly been allocating and assuming 1 metric ton of down mass devoted to science activities. And keep in mind, in addition, that does not include things like rovers and habitats and labs, because that mass is allocated within those elements. So this is 1 metric ton down mass specifically for instrumentation and payloads and things of that sort for science purposes. For the purposes of this study, we assumed 6 crew, and we had a whole set of ground rules and assumptions also that we use. Okay, so let's get into the operations themselves of the mission. Don't have time to go through all of this.
So, Marianne, you're at 5 minutes. Just
oh, okay. Well, then we'll zoom right through this. Okay. There are 7 phases in a typical Mars crewed mission. Don't want to go through these, but phase 0 is prior to cargo landing. You always do cargo, then followed by crew. We are right now in phase 0, in effect. Phase 1 is where you land your cargo. Then you have 3 really important phases, where you first land the crew, and there's a 30-sol period where they have to acclimate, not allowed to do EVA, setting things up, within the habitat, things of that sort. Then there's a 30-sol period after that where they're permitted to go EVA and do local exploration, so that's about 10 kilometers or so radius, in effect, around the habitation area. And then 410 souls of the 500 on the surface are devoted primarily to actually doing regional exploration, going out on regular traverses, then preparation for ascent, and then crew departure. So, not going to go through these, but we did identify the kinds of activities of each of these phases. So let's go to this one, the 30 souls when the crew first arrives. There's a whole bunch of stuff we've identified that they would have to do to get things going and set up. Now that gets to the point where in phase three, you have 30 soul period or phase where they can do local exploration. We actually looked into this with the science folks on our crew, on our team, about the kinds of things that they could be doing. We've laid that out in great detail. If you look at this chart, we've laid out actually a number of the things that, in working with them, they told us that they would really like to do during this period. We actually did work out day by day, soul by soul, number of crew, the types of operations, typical activities and operations that we would want the crew time to be used for. Here are some examples of more. And then we get to phase four, which is very important, and this is where they can do longer distance traverses away from the habitation area. We assumed each traverse is about 14 to 15 souls. So here's how it would work. Let me just get through this. You got your crew at your habitation area. Now they're getting ready to do their first traverse away from the habitation area in pressurized rovers. We have two pressurized rovers. The assumption is two crew in pressurized rover one, two crew in pressurized rover two. They go out together to the same basic zone, not necessarily in tandem. We are looking at how broad the distance is that they can be separated. But at the end of each sol, they find each other, come back again. If you noticed on the rover, there are hatches. They can dock. And they close up for the night, and that's where they stay. Next day, they unhook, go out again, and they do this cycle over about 15 souls. We assumed that you would probably want to do something like an initial characterization traverse. We heard a lot from everybody who do the field type of science that you have to figure out, really, if you can do your traverse path. Of course, you get imagery before you go, but you want to check it out. So you do a recon traverse and check things out, get out, take pictures, come back again, go back to your habitation area, and you use that time then to figure out in detail your follow-on traverses. If you follow this type of cycle, we were able to determine. Now, we don't have the information on the specific topography of the traverses. So it obviously they could take longer than we thought. But nonetheless, we planned a set of follow-on traverses. We looked at a geology geophysics focus and a shallow drilling focus. You can look at a whole bunch of them. There's a bunch of information in here then we don't have time to go through, but if you follow this type of cycle, you end up with 15 sol traverses, 23 two-hour EVAs.
So Marianne, we're at 15. We're basically at 15. So do you want to talk the reference sites or have Steve?
Well, that's it. Yeah. There they are. We worked them out, what it would take. We summarized them. They go home. Then you go home.
Okay.
And you want to use this, right?
So, sorry not to rush that, but we got a lot of, you know.
I get it.
Yeah, and Steve, I need you to briefly talk ideas or how y'all are thinking about reference sites, and then we'll get... And then, because we need to go on to the next thing, too.
Understood. So I want to put this back up there again for those of you who want to look at this report. We mentioned this. This was mentioned at one of the MEPEG meetings I think Marianne and I were at earlier this year.
Are you hot mic? You don't sound hot mic.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. Our intention is that we now have a 40-ish site database to work with. We want to go back to through those 40 sites and start looking for what we are calling reference sites. The reference sites we will use for analyses that are roughly equivalent to this. I don't know if we're going to have resources to go into the level of detail we went through with this particular study, but we could. We won't have the resources to do 40-ish detail analyses, so we have to downsize that to something smaller than that. We're talking, five-ish or less that we can we might have the ability to look at in some level of detail. Marianne, myself, and the others that are working on this will look at the information that you folks have provided and start to look at cases that will stress the systems and the operations that we're talking about here, stressing them in the sense, where do the things break? Where can we not do what we said we wanted to do? We would like you to help us with, by providing input to that, to the email address that you saw there, is to tell us in your, from your perspective, and I don't mean my site is the greatest, so go to my site, but which sites did you see during this these past few days that you think are stressing from an operations and systems as you understand them point of view, so we can take that into account. We will eventually make post somewhere, and I don't know where the somewhere is, so I'm not trying to be vague, but I just don't know. We will post somewhere what we're using as those reference sites, so people can see what we're working with. From my first order sense of what I've seen here, some of these high latitude sites, for reasons that the JPL folks mentioned, are going to be tough for thermal reasons, for probably lighting reasons, and so there's likely to be a high latitude site in amongst these things. So you can probably expect to see that. There are other ones that and we'll have to discuss this about what it, we think is going to stress the analyses that we have to do, but there will be other ones that will be put into that we will also look at for those kind of engineering analyses points of view. Just think of it that way. Don't hold me to this. Another example I could see is if somebody tells me there's this ice sheet, but it's 10 meters down, how would I deal with that? Or how would the engineers deal with getting to something that's 10 meters below the surface and accommodate planetary protection protocols, for example? Or some of these polyhydrated minerals of one sort or another, how do we deal with those? Those are the kinds of things that we are interested in, not necessarily to say yes or no, we're going to go to this site, but to say if we have the systems and operations and four people to work with, can we do what we think we want to do or not, and try and better inform ourselves and the people that we report to about what is reasonable to do on the surface, and where are we stretched to the breaking point. So we need to think of either new ways of doing it or saying, you know, you really may not want to think about doing something like that. So we're interested in your feedback. I don't know if you want to open it up now or just ask people to send in comments.
Let's come back to that when we okay. do the thing.
So that's the intention. Watch for that, and we'd appreciate your feedback via email if nothing else.
Okay, thanks, Steve. Okay, next, thanks. We'd like to have Andy come up here. So obviously planetary protection is a crucial piece, and so there were a lot of interesting comments during the week, and so I thought Andy wanted to just make a few words, and then we can open that up to Q&A a little bit. You know, the policies are obviously are in evolution.
Sure.
So why don't you...
So I had a sort of kind of an overview comment and then three things I specifically wanted to say. The overview is that, you know, I've sort of listened to the science presentations, and those people who know planetary protection well will know that I was sitting on my hands and biting my tongue for some of the presentations, just so that the science discussion can proceed. But a word to the wise. Whenever you get to the stage where you're proposing an activity, and when this becomes serious, then you better have a planetary protection story which aligns with whatever the planetary protection requirements of the day are going to be. And I can't predict that for you, but just bear that in mind. So in terms of the specific presentations, there's kind of three flavors of water which is identified for ISRU. There's the glacial ice, and then it's the RSLs, and then the hydrated minerals. Planetary protection is kind of agnostic to those. If you want to use those, that's fine, just as long as you have a process in place for making that acceptable for astronauts to drink and accessing it in a way where you haven't compromised the science. Okay, so that then already says to people like Steve that there needs to be a hardware associated with that, and it falls into the general trade space of how we might do the overall mission. Second thing is, you really can't speak out of both sides of your mouth. If on the one hand you're going to say there's this resource, there's this science region of interest where I'm predicting that there at least is going to be organic remnants or perhaps even extant life present. Oh, and by the way, we're going to use this resource. We're going to pipe it into the faucet in the galley of the habitat. Have the whole story there. Third thing is, I don't think that the special regions concept is going to go away. If there is an area of Mars which appears to be habitable, you don't get to make first access with an astronaut. I think that it's most likely the best solution is you send a robot first. Marianne mentioned that. Okay, so with that, I just wanted to make sure those points are coming across. And if there's any questions, either we can do it now or...
No, I'd like to open up just for a little bit. We'll do 5 minutes. But one thing I would say, Andy, is I'm thrilled you're here. It's really great to have you here. I would say the way you characterize, I think you guys need to be an integral part of this overall team, obviously.
Well, I'll make an observation from kind of... My first introduction to planetary protection was with the Beagle 2 mission. And I was brought in fairly late on, post-PDR. And they said, this is our concept. Tell me how to fix the planetary protection. And I'm looking at the concept and I'm thinking, you can't get there from here. Mm-hmm. Now, we ended up with a solution, but it was painful and expensive. If you integrate the planetary protection requirement at the beginning as just another engineering requirement that you have to meet, then it becomes the most cost-effective path. If you're part way down the process and you find out that you've done your testing, you've committed resource which you can't reaccess, then it's always going to be painful.
Okay, any questions for Andy? Yeah, right here.
Can we run a mic up there,
Jeff,
please?
Yes, Jeff Plout from JPL. I have a very basic question about the philosophy of planetary protection, because it really affects how we consider these things, the combination of resources and science. Can you use the same target for both, for example? So for the forward contamination situation, is the primary driver to actually protect Mars from forward contamination from Earth, or is it to protect the... Or is it to protect the scientific investigation from getting confused by forward contamination? So is it really planetary protection or is it science protection?
The second. So as COSPAR sort of governs planetary protection internationally, it has no remit to protect Mars for its own sake, for like an ethical kind of protection. It's about protecting science, your own science, and for future science.
Okay, over here. Can we get a mic over here, please?
I've got a mic right here.
Paul?
Okay.
Does the Planetary Protection Office think about, we talked about a lot of things that we don't know about Mars, and there's a lot of things we don't know about sort of planetary protection issues, like how to set appropriate requirements. More knowledge would be helpful to set better requirements. Is there a process in place that you guys are pursuing to try and figure out some of those questions?
Yeah, absolutely.
As far as payloads on missions or such things like that?
We haven't got as far as payloads on missions. We've got as far as these are knowledge gaps, which if they were closed, it would make the planetary protection story either easier to solve or easier to understand. So that is a path that NASA is on. The Planetary Protection Office at NASA headquarters has, through the workshop that I described in last March, now a list of unaddressed questions, which if they were all addressed, we can actually have some numeric, some numerics that we can go with. And if they're partially addressed, then maybe we'll have numerics with error bars, always taking into account that planetary protection perspective is going to be the conservative one.
Okay, yeah.
Andy, present planetary protection policy has a limit of 3 × 10⁵ viable microbial spores per landed event.
Right.
Individual humans have at least 10⁹
right.
microbial spores per human. In fact, there are more.
I think you're off by a couple of orders of magnitude. But yeah.
There are more microbial cells inside a human than there are human cells inside a human. So the landing of a human is not possible under current planetary protection policy.
Correct.
So my question for you is, what is your vision of the process and the timeline by which planetary protection policy will evolve to allow that to be possible?
So the process is with regard to this NPI that NASA already has in place, it kind of describes the pathway to addressing these issues. And yes, you're right, the paradigm has to change if we were ever going to deliver a human because of what you just said. I mean, we're essentially breaking the spore limit just by sending one human, never mind four or six. Pick your crew size. The timeline has to work. And you know, we don't actually have a timeline. Some of it is driven by availability of data, and we don't actually have that path mapped out yet. But clearly it has to mesh with the hardware design that goes along with how much stuff can we vent from our habitat. How much stuff is allowed to leak from an astronaut's cuff? Those issues are, you know, iterative, and we have to expend effort to answer the questions.
So, can we get a mic over here? We'll do two more questions, and Andy, I would pick on one word you use. That you said, if we when we send humans, I would say when we send humans. So, just a
if
nitpick.
That's your only criticism. <I'm>
Well, I would say there needs to be a transition policy, too, but we've talked about that, too. Yeah.
Hi, Nikki from UH Hilo. So I have two questions, actually. So obviously planetary protection restricts a biologist, like, a lot. So what can biologists do to work with you to make planetary protection policies less stringent so that we can actually have some room to do research? I mean, it's really difficult for us. So that's my first question. And then my second question is, when you do change these policies, or at least evolve them, are you going to be bringing in the biological community so that we can, you know, make our case, essentially?
Sure. So the way the policy is evolved, if I can answer the second question first, is that the Planetary Protection Officer has a Planetary Protection Subcommittee who are the great and the good, who come from diverse fields, including in biology. Penny Boston, for example, is on that committee, John Rummel. And so NASA is not working in a vacuum. And we also seek to involve our international partners in this process also, because you know we can leverage resources, for example, by involving other people to help us answer the questions. And so some of the questions that you want to know from a biology perspective, you know, how well does an enteric organism survive on Mars, a skin organism, what about spore formers? Those kinds of questions are questions which we, the planetary protection community, will be asking the biologists to tell us the answer to over the course of the next several years in order that we can evolve the policy.
Okay. And right here, we're good. Did you have a question?
No, it's okay.
Okay. All right. So we'll stop there and go on to that. Thank you, Andy. Obviously, a critical topic. I need you to call up. So I'm going to talk a little bit about this prototyping thing, just to kind of give you some context for what we're trying to do here. Can you not put that up quite yet? Just leave it there for now. So the idea here is we have done imaging for sites with MRO and, you know, for rover missions, you know, extensively and that sort of thing. What we have not done is we've not had to worry about what's needed in terms of imaging and in terms of data collection for an exploration zone. So we, as everyone has acknowledged this week, are really in completely new territory. And there's several components in terms of what we need to figure out how to do. So there is the component that this week we've asked all the presenters to tell us what data they need. So that's a very important perspective. There is a perspective in this room in terms of an aggregate of what we all think we need. And then from a NASA perspective, there's a, you know, we have another piece, which is, you know, what do we think we need from an agency standpoint to do this? We have to try to find that overlap, and that will actually drive the next step in terms of where we want to go with these landing site proposals. So first thing I want to say, so that leads to this idea of prototyping. The idea fundamentally is we are not smart enough to pick a to do an announcement of opportunity at the present time, but we intend to do it, and we hope that we get everybody here proposing. You all are all now smarter about what we're kind of looking for, where the information gaps are. You know, so if you're a geologist and you realize that there's astrobiology questions or ISRU questions, and you get this whole idea now, we all get it, that really integrated teams really start becoming a key component going forward, that thing. I would even go so far as to say that when we do this announcement, we would be hoping for more than 45 proposals. We would be looking for every one of you guys and more. And I actually think that what will happen is we'll see it ramp up, and then we'll start the process of actually narrowing down to do what Jim Green described, you know, for example, last night, where we really start boiling this down. And that's a fundamentally a multi-year process. So let me see what comments other had here. So can you go ahead and show the thing? So what we're going to show you right now is we're going to mail this out to y'all. I'm hoping we can get it out by Wednesday. We do have a mic, and I'll just go talk. So that's not working. I'll just talk to you. That's fine. And can I? Does this work? Okay. So let's go through this. So we're going to send you this form. These are actually grouped by the sessions. That's the order that they're in. So fundamentally, there's a divide between the lower latitude and the mid latitudes that you actually saw today. And that's probably a fairly defining characteristic. When we send this to you, our intention is to make these presentations available. So we got to get that set up. But these will be linked so that you can actually refer back to that. Fundamentally, the criteria, which is essentially the second announcement for this thing, we'll provide a link to that too, because it should be tied to that criteria. And then really what we're asking you to do is, you heard amazing presentations this week, and we're asking for your inputs, and it's advisorial. I mean, in the end, we have to, you know, but that's the intention, is we want your feedback. Tell us your three that you thought were really pretty compelling in terms of having diverse science, diverse ISRU, and really mapping to that criteria. And this is not excluding anybody. This is purely for prototyping. But the idea is that we want to hear what you're saying here. The second column is another, which is another one, which is that they're clearly, particularly in the up mid-latitude ones, there are data voids. But is that a little better? A little more, Josh.
They know what the list of
yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Fair. This one is the way I would characterize this column, and if Ben disagrees with me, scream, Ben. This column is really saying, you heard all these presentations were really, but some of them, which ones were really interesting, but we just don't have enough data yet. And so, again, that kind of points to a lot of up in northern, you know, mid-latitudes, where, you know, we really have spotty coverage. And so which ones are, I'm going to use this term, cool or look promising, maybe other adjectives to use, but we need more data. And what I envision for this effort to help us to figure out what we need in the AO is we'll cherry-pick one or two from here. We'll cherry-pick from one or two from here. And then we're going to go get smart about how you do this. And then we will build a robust AO as opposed to one that we would be basically uninformed. You know, and so, and then per, you know, John Grunsfeld's comment, you know, you don't have to do this, but really filling out the why you think it's an interesting one is informative, and we really want your feedback on this. Yeah, Alfred.
Yeah, can we get a mic for Alfred, please?
Thanks, Josh.
For many of these, I would debate, you know, which column to put it into.
Right.
There's a clear break between those where we've sent rovers already and we have that in-situ information. So I would change just to one for which a strong case can be made on current data, and those are the places we've already landed with rovers.
Yeah.
And have five where current data is uncertain instead of three and three. Because I think there's a clear break there between those two categories.
Alfred, explain that just a little bit more, make sure I'm...
So we have several sites we've sent rovers.
Right.
There's Gusev Crater, Gale Crater, Meridiani. We know a whole lot about those sites. It's really a different category.
Right.
All the rest of them, the data is uncertain, in my opinion. Mm-hmm. It's just a matter of degree.
Mm-hmm.
So do you think we should prototype one and five, or are you saying we should
Well,
and I don't think it's just where the rovers have gone. It's the ones that were studied for rovers.
You don't know the particle size distribution from remote sensing data. It's only the sites that we've sent rovers there that we have certain information, and I think that's a distinct category. We should do one of those, not three of them.
Okay, and to be clear, the three means you pick three of these that you think fit this criteria. I want to make sure we're clear on that.
Well, I'm just suggesting you change it to one for A and five for B, because I think that's a fairer representation given that natural break.
Okay, sure.
And how.
All right, so we'll let us think about that. Okay, that's an interesting idea. And again, we're asking you, this is where we are, but we'll figure it out and get something out on Wednesday.
Rick. Yeah. Lauren Markle, I'm assuming that the criteria for three and three is you're beginning to look for an overlap of consensus between all the different.
Yes, and then it's also intended, let me address this, because, if someone has proposed one, it's trying to force people to actually go out of the box.
Right, yeah. And based on current data is whatever is there. Understand there is a lot missing from whatever region that you may be most interested in, but whatever data is there, I mean, you have to begin to at least make your best guess to take that next step.
Right.
Another question I have is, I know I learned a lot in this process. Is there an opportunity for the presenters to supplement some of the data that was perhaps missing in the original presentation?
So we have not talked about, that's a great point. We need to be moving out on this kind of an idea, but we hear you, so let us think about that. Questions? Yeah,
Melissa Rice, Western Washington University. I have a comment and a question. The comment is, or maybe it's a suggestion, to lump the sites for which multiple presentations were given for a single exploration zone into a single line on here, so that we're voting for an exploration zone and not a presenter, or else it becomes a popularity contest.
Right.
And then my question is, I'm a little unclear on exactly how this process of selecting a prototype easy feeds into the process of creating an AO. So if you could elaborate on that a little bit.
Okay, so first comment, we'll think about it. That's a great. Second comment is that, so we have there's a balance between the tree, having your nose up against a tree, versus the forest. And we're trying, and this is a process where there's a big gap between the two. And so we asked people as they developed their proposals to actually tell us what data needs they have to hone it down further. That is the tree view, frankly. We, on the SMD and HEOMD sides, we're trying to figure out what we need in terms of data on exploration zones as well. That's the forest view. And we have to try to slide these two into convergence or overlap, if you will. Let me finish. And this prototyping will actually help us to do that. And then that would actually inform the process by which we can then write a decent AO. Right now we could not write a decent AO because we don't know.
Yeah. Just to add on to that, I think Bryony Horgan, Purdue University, there's also a difference between what data we need and what work needs to be done. And I think
that's right.
Hopefully, because I know at my site, we don't need more data, but there needs to be mapping work.
Right. And the idea behind an AO is recognizing that there's work underway. Yeah. So, that's the kind of thing.
Can you just Rick? Step over a bit?
There. Thank you.
Hey, Rick. Rick, back here in the back.
Yep. Okay. Yeah.
So, Charles Wetzel, JPL, NASA JPL. In all due deference, I want to respond to something that Alfred said. Technically, I don't think we can legitimately say we've sent any missions to any EZs. we've sent them to specific science ROIs that might be encompassed in some of the EZs that have been proposed, right? And as we're talking about the what additional data needs to be gathered, I like Bryony's comment about what additional work needs to be done with the data that's already been gathered. We also need to, I think we are, but we need to keep an eye on additional data to be gathered from future remote sensing missions, as well as the data to be gathered from additional in situ missions, either to science ROIs or resource ROIs as well, because some of these are going to need ground truth, not just to make the case on the science side, but make the case on resources side.
Although that, following your logic, that would suggest you don't have two columns, you have maybe one, I think, but we need to go look at that.
Yeah, there's different timescales associated with those different data needs.
That's right. Right here.
Mike Siebert, JPL. This is just a logistical question. Were the Ustream feeds archived so we can go back and rewatch?
Yes, they are. They are.
All right.
And the other thing, too, is, again, we're going to make these presentations. We do. The comment resonates about needing to figure, you know, maybe giving people a chance to update, potentially. We'll go look at that. And we'll get word out as fast as we can. Right here.
Just to clarify briefly.
Say your name.
Oh, sorry. Ben Boatwright, Harvard University. Just to clarify, so this process of picking prototype EZs where we think we're picking these based off of like overall science potential.
Yeah. Be clear. There is criteria for an EZ that is not just science potential. It is actually ISRU potentials and all those things. When you pick yours, I would strongly recommend go looking at that criteria as it stands today, and help do this.
Yeah, sorry. I was just trying to say this is like best overall. Okay. My actual question is this going to be related at all in any way to what you mentioned before about picking EZs in terms of the stress things with the engineering aspects?
That's a conversation we need to have on a steering committee basis. That's a fair question.
But for now, those are separate.
Focus on this right now.
Okay.
I got a mic over here.
Jeff Plout at JPL. Sorry. Beat you to the punch. I'm trying to understand column B, for which current data are uncertain, I think it means to say. Let me frame the question. Current data could mean current understanding, so there's like maybe there's a gap in just the analysis of the existing data.
Yeah.
Maybe there are more observations that can be taken with existing assets, and that's a huge part of this, I think, because we need to give some direction to the current orbiters, for example.
Right.
And then there are new kinds of data from instruments that don't exist yet, or there's in situ data. So I understand this is a narrow, it's only to help select the prototype EZs, but all of those different kinds of new understanding, new information are part of this process. What are we trying to do in this column here? Which one should we focus on?
So the intent, but we're going to have to go, we're going to go rethink with all these inputs. The intent is, we're not going to have a new satellite for a while. So we have the data we have and this data collection systems we have. So the intent was to say, where are we having voids in that for that particular EZ? It's not talking future data.
So in other words, to direct the current remote sensing for targeting soon.
That's right.
In the near term.
That's right.
Okay.
Yep. Okay. Matt. Hang on. Matt's got, and then we'll go.
Over here when you.
So just listening, as someone who's lived through five landing site selections on Mars in detail, I think B is always, every site needs new data.
Yeah.
And I just wanted to remind everyone of the process that we go through for robotic site selection that includes effectively complete high-rise DTM coverage across the entire landing site, complete rock maps, complete material properties maps, and this is for a robot that isn't even trying to use anything, and I think the requirements for a human landing site are going to be even greater. So now, put that into perspective, your 100-kilometer radius zone, at some point you would want complete high-rise stereo coverage or the equivalent, complete rock maps. You'd want complete material properties to do traffic ability.
But I don't think we're there.
But the point is that I was trying to put, I think what is in B here is what missing information would help understand that site better from both a science and or a RSU standpoint. There's key information that would help that site.
Yeah.
And that's what we ought to be focusing on, because you're not going to get in this go-round immediately everything you need.
Well, we don't even know what we need.
Yeah, so you're just making a first step there.
Yeah. Okay, over here.
Yeah, Rick, Doug Archer, Jacobs at NASA JSC. Could you say just a little bit, when you say an AO, what exactly do you mean? Do you mean putting out something through the ROSES program that we write grants to, and it's a multi-year standard thing, or what exactly do you mean?
So announcement of opportunity is basically a sort of an I call it SMD terminology, but it's essentially, it is a, it is, we define some work, people can bid to it or build proposals to it, and then we accept proposals and there's money associated with it is the bottom line.
Okay, so I know you said that you can't write a competent one yet, and that's kind of the point here, but what kinds of work would you be soliciting? The type of mapping efforts that we're looking at, lab work, is this going to be really open or narrowly defined?
It could be elemental traverse planning. We're not smart enough to know that yet, because we have to actually, coming into this workshop, we were trying to draft it, but we really got to a point where we wanted to hear what everyone was saying to do that. And we also wanted to see what people were saying as their data needs. So we're not smart enough to do that yet, but we intend to get smart enough quickly.
Okay, so, thanks.
Can we get right here?
Yeah, just a quick comment. I understand the need for data from orbiters and the like, but from the ISRU point of view, I think it is important to start taking a look at the dichotomy in terms of Martian terms that is used here in hydrated minerals versus water ice. Some very basic studies that are needed to figure out, the effect of ice structure, the overburden. Very basic thing to determine which one is going to be more feasible before we start making the decisions.
No, we agree. In fact, as Jim Watson and Jim Green both talked about last night, the whole resource thing is a real driver. Mm-hmm. And where we can get clarity, and frankly, having what you can determine from orbit, it may be even drive some answers, because you ultimately need to determine quantities.
Absolutely.
And that's gets a little tricky on the hydrated mineral side. But
absolutely.
Okay, Alex, and then we'll move. Okay, yeah, we'll get you.
For the purposes of selecting reference sites, I know we have three different EZs for each rover site, but just to give each rover site a fair chance at being selected as a reference EZ, maybe for the purposes of the voting, we should just simply lump them, Gale Crater, Meridiani, and Gusev, just so that we can give each of those sites a fair representation instead of like splitting the votes into thirds.
Mm-hmm. All right, we'll think about it. I mean, then it starts being us interpreting the data too. So, there's a balancing there. Ben, did you have anything you want to add right now? Okay.
Fred Caleb, JPL. I think one of the things that, just because of practicality in terms of this huge bi-lane site standards exploration zone, that we have the numbers of what percent high-rise coverage do we have, what percent is in stereo, what percent CTX coverage, although we know it's almost 95% of all sites, but, what percent is stereo, those are numbers that we can generate to at least give us an idea. If there's, I don't know how many high-latitude sites are, let's say there's 20. If three of those have, 50% or greater coverage, maybe that's a dream, but whatever the number is, those sites should move to the top just because, one thing I came out of this workshop was that the science is good everywhere. And I think, to me, is that it's becoming less of a discriminating factor, and it may just come down to raw numbers. How much coverage do we have now? How much coverage do we think we can gain in X years with what we have? Especially in terms of the near term, if you got a site that has 30% coverage and this other site has 5%, are we going to try to put the 5% up to 30%, or are we going to take the 30% and say it's good, or make that 35%, and thereby you're really increasing the knowledge with what you have?
The hazard you run is that it can be the tail wagging the dog, because you have data coverage that was driven by the needs of robotics precursors that were also limited by a lot of other things. You know,
I know, but I mean, I think there is also a, you know, poor Alfred's probably gonna have a heart attack, and he's like, cover every 100 kilometers with a high rise. It's just practically impossible.
Yeah, we totally get that. Okay, and Ben, right here. Sorry if I'm missing somebody. And these are real, this is a sausage making. We know it. So, you know, you're helping us define it.
So, Pan Conrad from NASA Goddard. The only way I can see to do this is the way I'm going to do this. So I'm going to lay this out here as an offer. So I've got a couple of sites that I got really interested in just on the basis of the talks. So what I'm going to do is write a narrative and tell the story. And then what I want is for everybody else to poke holes in the story, because the holes are where we derive that information that you're asking for. And what I need to know from you is when you need it.
So let us, what I would say, I'm curious, let us take all this feedback into account. We'll do this first part of next week. Is that, do you think? Yeah, I mean, we want to get moving on this, you know, because this really starts, there is a bit of seriality here, if you will, if that's a word. you get the idea. It is serial. So we want to make sure that we get it, right. So let us think that through.
I think we've had lots of good discussion this morning. There's lots to go away and digest, and I think steering committee needs to do that, and then come up with a plan.
Okay, up here.
Laurence Bill, Kennedy Space Center. A general question, because I'm not familiar with the access to the tools. Is the European Space Agency tools or orbital assets also part of?
No, we were not planning on that.
No, that's not part of that picture. And
we just haven't.
Yeah, I mean, there's no reason why they shouldn't be. I guess I don't know how. I personally don't know how it works for targeting. Okay. It would be an obvious thing. It would be silly not to include those remote sensing capabilities and see if we can request, if there's key data to request. But maybe it would be useful to try and come up with a précis of what is available on Mars Express, etc., and then give that out to the easy people who wrote the abstract so that they can think about that too.
Right. And again, from an ISOU perspective, we have no idea, so we need some briefings on that. And could you maybe comment at this point about how you see an ISRU or mining group being formed, or how do you want this to contribute? Because if you want that dialogue to continue in earnest in the next 2 weeks, you need to think about how to organize it.
I don't see that happening in the next 2 weeks, but I mean, let us get a little further on this and take this feedback into account. And then what other questions exist out there right now? Yeah, Paul.
So I just wanted to say, don't take the silence of all of the scientists in the room to be saying all the science is good. We're all silently seething, but but you know, we were, you know, this was about sharing different ideas, and that was great. I also wanted to say, just sort of clarify these two columns. I think the first one is, which of the EZs, you know, you thought made a convincing case by itself, and the other one is, which one do you think has potential, but you know, maybe didn't make a convincing case to you? I think that's another way to sort of think about this.
I mean, to me, part of this prototyping EZ is to help us work out the path forward, and then there are differences in people who had an EZ that had received a lot of remote sensing coverage were able to make a different case for those that had less coverage. So to me, if we have one EZ from somewhere which has lots of coverage, we can run with that and work out what do we want to do next with that kind of EZ, which might be a different process for an EZ that has received less coverage. And how do we get them both to the same place before we do any kind of winnowing?
Okay, any other questions for now? Yeah, right here.
Is
So I know I probably all the proposers are kind of like, oh, what if my site doesn't get selected for one of these proto? And I know this it's not supposed to be any kind of favoritism or anything, but I think as we've seen in all of these landing site selection processes, the more attention a site gets, the better it looks.
Yeah.
And so how, what is there some kind of idea for how to deal with
so that? So you really, I would say, is that this is just to inform a more extensive process that is key. And really, we all benefit from the more extensive process, because right now, what you're seeing, you know, we're even having a group discussion about what the columns mean. You know, so it's an unconverged solution set. So this is intended to inform that process. So we can, the next round of this will be much more robust, and you know how to play the game better. You know, that's what it's about. And you know, it's a little messy, but that's kind of part of creating something new. Ben, you have something you want to add to that?
Yes. I mean, just to be clear, so that people understand the difference, the prototype EZ site is a concept to help us design the process going forward using an actual EZ. The reference EZs that you just heard, the idea behind those is they bracket the engineering extreme, so that if they design systems for those reference EZs, they can, you saw from Marianne the level of detail that goes into these. If they do that for ones that bracket the engineering constraints, then they know that it works in other locations, so you don't have to do that depth of analysis on every single EZ. So that's what there is. They're fundamentally different, just to make, I wasn't sure that was clear to everyone.
Charles, then we'll
I think you kind of answered the question that I was going to ask, because I was picking up a sense of discomfort among here. Maybe if we focus more on the reference EZs, because people talked about the most promising ones. Steve talked about the most demanding ones or something like that. But it feels to me like the community be best served by picking the most representative of different classes of sites?
These are two different things.
Okay.
One, we're trying to figure out eventually where we send human beings. So we have to start converging down the requirements for that. The reference sites really are engineering things, and they're different than the robotic missions. Robotic missions, as you well know better than I do, were driven largely by entry, descent, and landing, you know, things, and you need more stringent, you know, you need to stress those cases. And with the human landing site, you know, we're basically powering our way to a landing. So it's a precision landing. It's a different beast. Now, that doesn't mean you don't do traverse planning, or you don't, you know, figure out thermal, you know, issues for different altitudes or whatever. And that's where the idea of reference EZ still plays, which is what Ben described. But really, we're trying to define with this how we take this process that we started this week, you know, to the next level.
Yeah, it feels like in some of these cases we talked about before about the time scale over which more data is going to become available. You always make a better decision with more data in hand.
Right.
So kind of balancing the needs to get more specific sooner rather than later versus making a less than optimal decision on less data available now than will be available in the future.
Yeah, so. But the way Penn described it actually, you know, for me personally, resonates very strongly, which is that really, the narrative that John Grunsfeld was even talking about is what we want. Why was this a really neat? Why did it seem to do it for you? You know, and there were some clearly ones where you can sort of start seeing all these pieces coming together. You know, they are going to completely rock. All of these will rock, even on the next rev of this thing. You know, but we got to figure out how we hone those words down, and you're part of the process. So that's wish it were a little cleaner, but Merry Christmas, you're part of it. Any other, yeah.
Melissa Rice, Western Washington University. I just want to say before we wrap up this discussion, a thank you for putting in this effort to make a thoughtful AO. I know that there are several of us on the science side in the room who have been involved in multiple Mars rover landing site processes and all of that. Science analysis and mapping has been done more or less as a labor of love, pro bono.
Mm-hmm.
And so the prospect of being supported to do this work, I think, is really exciting for all of us, and also is really going to broaden the fraction of our community that can participate in this.
Yeah, that's great. Right here.
Yeah, Justin Simon, Johnson Space Center. I, as a scientist, I absolutely agree with that comment. But in practical terms, this occurred to me that we have a certain timeline, as we were referring to. There's a lot of exciting science, but can we get to the point where we have the ability to get there for all these sites? I mean, we could talk about what types of orbital campaigns we could potentially get, but we only have, you know, a decade or whatever it is to really start settling in on it. And so there's going to be really practical eliminating factors that are going to cut out, you know, 75% of those.
So
just to be practical.
Right, no. And I don't know if you've had a chance to look at actually the current in the second announcement for this. We actually have an integrated between HEOMD, SMD, and now STMD. They're all engaged on this thing. And so those are not perfect constraints by any means. I don't think we would ever try to advertise them in that. We're going to take the feedback here and try to hone those down more. But it's a convergence process. And those constraints are science, ISRU, and engineering.
Yeah. So I get where you're coming from, okay. Absolutely. But I think that even in these, if in the best case, although some of these are very attractive scientifically, we won't be able to get there.
Well, actually, all of these sites met the initial criteria.
I meant in terms of the you know, the in-situ resources and all the
right
details of that.
Yeah, we totally get that. I mean, you know, there were topics like, for example, you know, how accessible is a hydrated mineral? Is it solid, you know, essentially a solid rock, or right, were you talking dust? I mean, there's a massive difference in that. Can you tell that from on orbit?
Right.
You know, so, yeah, we hear you loud and clear. Yeah, up here, we'll do two more, and then we'll move on. Unless, Ben, what you want to do?
So, Jake Bleacher, Goddard Flight Center. I'm just going to throw a monkey wrench out here real quick. No matter how many times we say that we're not trying to rule any sites out or promote any sites through this process here, I think hearing everybody talk, everybody is still very emotionally attached to their site. And picking one of these sites as a prototype EZ, even if we say many, many times in capital letters and bright, bold, whatever, it's still going to be viewed as us picking sites. So maybe, I'm just going to throw an idea out there, but maybe we need another column, or maybe it's the rationale column that says what the really interesting aspects to the site are, and then maybe pick one or two sites that are not on this list that possess some of those characteristics, and make a prototype that is not one of these sites that was picked here, that everyone can maybe in an unbiased manner evaluate as a community, if we really are just trying to go through the process. Because I liked what Pan said earlier about sitting down with everybody from the different communities and really going through the rubric, or an evolved form of the rubric. But I just feel like if it's four of these sites, people are going
to
be getting behind it.
To be clear, we are expecting more sites proposed at the next workshop than what we had this time. So, but we can't really go to that next level if we don't develop these pieces. And, you know, if you want to push the ball down the field, and this is what this is about, even though we're at the beginning of the field, if you want to push the ball down the field, you got to start somewhere. And, you know, frankly, if you don't try it with something, and nothing better than to actually try it with a couple things that are actually been built by this amazing community, rather than all anew. So we just need to understand that we have to take steps. You know, I lived in Russia for 3.5 years, and they have a wonderful expression, shagza shagam, which means step by step in English, but when you go through a Russian winter, it has a whole nother meaning. And this is really about taking some of those shogs or steps. You know, how do we get through the murk right here to try to figure out a really robust path? It should not be threatening to anybody, because this is really to help us make a really robust attack plan. And that's all it's doing. Okay, one more question, then we'll move on. Yeah, right here. Well, let me see. You've already asked a bunch. Sorry, I'm going to see. Hang on. Any other? Okay, right here, then. We'll let you have it.
Ben Boatwright, Harvard University. I think this is sort of just a good concluding thing as well. So in terms of, you know, you're talking about this second workshop that's going to happen. So again, do you think in terms of, you know, you're probably going to give some sort of, like we got this kind of preliminary information, what people should be looking for when they're choosing a landing site. So do you think that in that sense, is it going to be more important for people to know information about this kind of thing, where we're picking again, landing sites based on their overall science, ISRU, engineering potential? Or should people also be informed of these sort of limitations, the extreme cases? Is there going to, sorry, this is kind of repeating my question from before, but I'm still a little unclear on it. So I guess, is there going to be some sort of synthesis between looking for this sort of just like the goodness that was mentioned earlier, as opposed to sort of the limits of what not to choose in terms of these sort of extremes of
so
engineering constraints?
Maybe the way I would characterize it right now, what we need in a human exploration zone is unknown, really. We are at the beginning of that process where we have to figure that out still. We did a first cut. You all saw it. You interacted with it. We need to go to the next level. And so you are at a very unconverged state right now. It's actually the fun part, even though it is messy. And so what this is about is trying to take at least a few little steps to help us converge that down in a forum, open forum, where we can actually get all the ideas on the table to make this thing. The current criteria, I would say, are good. But there's no way you would send a crew there based off that criteria. And so we need to keep pushing that envelope so we actually come up with a robust, defensible plan. And this is about trying to figure out how you do that. Okay, so we'll stop there. Next thing, maybe we should take a small little break, and then I'll keep going. Okay, so the last thing we're going to do is, can we bring up the questions? And do you want to talk to them, or how do you want to do that?
They're at the end of my presentation.
Yeah. So what we're going to do, so a lot of these were covered already this morning, but we wanted to make sure that we didn't miss anything. And so these are the question lists that we are soliciting feedback on from people. So we're just going to go clicking through them and make sure we didn't miss anything. And feel free. And you're going to have up to 2 weeks. We're going to send you a link to this thing. And if you want to send it to us over the next 2 weeks, that's fine. You know, this is, I'm not going to mince words. We're going to do this as in an advisorial way, but your feedback is crucial. I think we've demonstrated that we're serious about that. And then I think on the easy concept, Steve, you want to come up here and help me with this? Or you want to?
Unless you want to.
Well, I'll both of you chime in.
Yeah. Well, yeah, don't be shy.
So, I think what we're hearing, and we already covered this with Ben's thing, I think we're hearing that the easy concept seems to work. Does anyone have any other comments on that they would like to make before we press out of that one? Anybody? Yeah.
Just a quick comment. The easy concept is...
You need a mic.
Yeah. Sorry. Can we run mics, please? We're going to run mics that are here. That's fine.
Yeah, just a quick comment on the easy concept. Yeah. Easy concept so far is based to first order on a radial distance from a landing site.
Right.
And as you probably know or suspect, what really matters ultimately, especially at ranges of 100 kilometers or so, is the time it takes to get you there.
Right, we heard that.
Right. So in that sense, that's the only thing I wanted to point out about the easy concept.
Okay. Yeah. I think we did cover that one. With data collection, I think we covered MRO. The third data point, the new data types needed that will assist. We could spend the rest of our time talking about new data sets. I would strongly suggest, we've heard lots of discussions, particularly related to better understanding of resources, but that's something we definitely would value feedback on over the next couple of weeks.
Yeah, and let's amplify that a little bit. We are, I think you heard from Jim Watson's talk last night. There's a lot of discussions underway on that. So, you know, this guy, you know, spend a little bit of time here, 2 weeks, in thinking about that. I mean, there is a science analysis group off doing it, but you're seeing the whole thing starting to come together. We welcome thoughts on that.
Yeah, I mean, the ground truth one, there's another way of raising that, which is we had one of the presentations made a very, I thought, interesting suggestion, which is they wanted Curiosity to go and visit a particular geologic unit and make a measurement, and that was actually going to help them with EZ. So other examples of actually where the rovers could take measurements that would be of immediate benefit to better understanding the value of EZ, would love to hear those.
So, and I just want to amplify on what Ben's saying. We have rover assets, obviously. We have things in orbit that are assets. You know, help us figure out how we push the ball down the field on these things with those existing assets. they weren't necessarily designed to address the problems we're doing, but you know, how can we cleverly use them? And we need your ideas on that.
I have sort of a question about that. Yeah. I do remote sensing work, and sometimes we very confidently declare which minerals we've discovered, and then sometimes we visit those deposits and Mars surprises us and so on. And it's not that there's anything wrong with the technique, but one way to look at this is what measurements do we need that we would allow us to bet our lives or someone else's life on the material that's there. And so that to echo what maybe I think Jake Leacher or someone else said, it may be inevitable that down the road we're going to have to ground truth stuff robotically before we are willing to bet lives on it. But that's, as a remote sensor, I feel confident about what we see, but there are uncertainties in terms of abundances and purity.
So you have anything you want to add? So the only thing I would add to that is that I think, you know, we at the NASA have a presupposition that there will be precursors and that you're going to have ground truth. Now, it's none of that's funded, you know, bluntly speaking, but, you know, you're going to have to do something to validate those sites. And, you know, for example, if we end up saying that, you know, we need to be near sheet ice, for example, you better at some point actually go validate that you can actually do that. You know, that water's not dangerous, you know, and that kind of thing. So those are pieces that start to form when you do this. Okay, any questions about that? Okay, anything?
Dave?
Let me back up one I forgot. I'd like to follow up on what Pascal said. We've had 2 days of discussion of how much scientific interest there might be within a 200-kilometer diameter circle. Is the broad consensus of this group is that there are places on Mars where there is enough stuff to occupy the attention, excuse me, of repeated visits of human crews at that scale? Or should we put the pressure on technology developers like Steve to widen it to 200 or shorten it to 50? You know, and the 100 was sort of a made-up figure to some extent at this point, but we've now seen examples of how much diversity there is at that scale on Mars as we understand it.
And I would say part of that comes back to people have been asking about the mobility speed question. What I think getting the information out from the EMC folks, this is how long we think it would take typically to get 20 kilometers away from the habitation, and if you allow time for the geologic field work, that would provide details. And that's what they're going to do with the reference sites. I think we will get an answer to that from the reference sites. When they use the reference sites and do the really detailed EVA and whole, you know, whatever length day mission, I think we'll see if in, say, 500 days they're done after 250 or they've only gone a few kilometers from the habitation site. I think that will help answer that.
Yeah. Ben, I just wonder, while we have this group together, maybe it's worth calling for a show of hands or something. Given what we've seen, does 100 kilometers seem like it's got enough stuff to be a good starting point?
Yeah. A lot of hands.
Okay, let's ask that a different way. Who thinks that we need, if you're going to send, let's say, as is currently, say, 5 crews, who thinks that you need more than a 100 kilometer radius area to explore to keep them busy scientifically?
Yes. Go ahead, Pam.
So, I don't think it's, with all due respect, I don't think it's the right time to ask that question, because it depends on the density of cool stuff, whether or not it's 50, 100, or 200 kilometer radius. The more important question I think that we need to address is, can we work with this for a little while right now to come up with these scenarios? And what you know from the existing missions, especially MER, who cares what we say? What we're really going to do is exceed that. And so let's use this as a constraint for now, and if we need to do something different, then we will.
Okay. Go ahead.
Yeah, and the reason why I raised my hand really is to point out that, once again, 200 kilometers may seem a lot, but if it's on a known route that has been established by Crew 1, it takes you 2 days to get out there. And from then on, you could explore some things that's at 250.
Yeah, but you know, Pan's right. point resonates with me. We have to start somewhere.
I agree with
somewhere.
Pam's point. I agree with as well. What I'm trying to say is I was trying to explain why I thought expanding it was not unreasonable.
Yeah. The difference between expanding it to pi r squared right. and maybe the odd spoke.
Right, exactly.
So from my perspective, and I'm guilty of putting the 100-kilometer number in there. So
him there.
Me? From my perspective, what I heard over the past couple of days is that people could work with that number, and there's a lot of really interesting places that can go. People can go, and within a 100-kilometer radius circle, do a lot of stuff. Now, does the answer turn into 250? Does the answer turn into 50? I think Pan is right. We're not at a point where we can say that now. And so maybe the better way to ask that question is what was said. Is 100 good enough to work with right now as different enough from a robotic site as we currently use it to get at this idea that we've got humans and we've got multiple crews of humans with mobility to do an interesting job, to be productive over that period of time. So I don't know if you want to show a host.
No, well, my conclusion. They essentially did,
well,
in my
okay,
mind.
So my conclusion is that the answer to that is yes, and there's at this time there's no compelling reason to change it from 100 kilometers to something else right now. I think we should work with that for a while, my opinion, and just let people refine what they've done over the past couple of days, and then we can get a better idea of whether it needs to be different than that. I'm sure we can all find a site where if we could go 500 kilometers, we could do some really cool stuff. But we've got to make the trade-off between what does it cost you to do a 500-kilometer radius kind of circle. So I think unless somebody, maybe Jake has a violent disagreement here, but
he just wants to go to the restroom. You can go.
So unless somebody has a violent disagreement with that, my proposal would be to leave it at 100 right now, and let's just see how that continues to evolve, and we can make adjustments later.
And just to clarify, Steve says he originated the original idea. He did, but the reality is the entire steering committee agreed with it. So I mean, so it's that there is it's really a team thing. Okay.
Okay.
No, I was just gonna say the same thing. I mean, if you can't find something to do in 200-kilometer across diameter circle, you're not trying very hard.
You've gone to the wrong place.
Yeah, you okay. picked the wrong site. And the other aspect to this is that doing science in a big circle is not a matter of going from A to B and then B's done and coming back. This is going to be a staged process where you start in a short-term exploration, defining units, characterizing and mapping unit relationships. Then you build your way out away from your landing zone, because if you don't have the context set first, you're not going to have any clue what the needle that you're looking for means. So then you go into the more detailed studies. So I agree with Steve. There's not really any reason to have a debate about that. There's going to be plenty to do, and you have to keep in mind that it's not a go to the lava flow, pick up a sample, lava flow's done type of process.
I think we're going to move forward because we've got more to cover, not much time left.
So the next one is, it's really getting at the idea of what are the other data analysis that we can do now with these EZs and soliciting feedback on that. So, you know, detailed traverse analyses may not be warranted right now given how unconverged the EZs are. So this is really soliciting ideas on next steps there. And this one is a more global, you know, type of thing, but this one's probably a key piece right here. Does anyone have any comments on that, if that's clear? Yeah. We'll get you.
I know you mentioned not doing detailed traverse analysis, which I actually do agree with, but I think going back and having everyone go through their exploration zone and instead of the 100, I'm fine with the 100 kilometers. I'm just going to put that out there, even as a rover driver for this point in the planning. It's a good number to work with because we don't have a reasonable number yet. There are things where you know you can't drive through some craters and everything, and you can kind of start making they look more like a cartoon character where you're going to have lobes in your exploration zone. But that can be done just drawing lines in Google Earth. So I think that would be reasonable to look at is things you know are traverse hazards, exclude them, and then we can start refining this.
Okay.
Any other comments on this one right now? Yeah, over here. we get a mic over here, please, Kevin? Thanks.
Yeah, Doug Ming, JSC. We heard a lot about resources over the course of the 3 days, and it's obviously becoming very important for this whole campaign. The one thing that I think is missing is that not all hydrated minerals are alike. We all know the problem of getting the quantities, but there's also another issue that needs to be addressed, that is extracting the water. There are phytosilicates that are aluminum-rich in the octahedral layer that will require temperatures of over 800 degrees to get the water out. The polyhydrated sulfates, much lower temperatures, and that's one area that I didn't hear people talk about, and I think that may make a major, it should be a major concern in the type of material we go after as far as getting extracting water from.
Yeah, so I agree. If I can come back, we did talk about that this morning under the dialogue, the idea of potentially having specialized resource workshops where we would focus on a particular hydrated mineral and get the mining community there and really work out how much of a resource is it.
Yeah, good. I missed that discussion.
But that's really crucial because, you know, obviously we're going to be energy limited, so making sure this stuff really makes sense. And constraining, where we feel comfortable constraining, helps converge the solution set, too. Okay, what else? All right, so the next one is a feedback. We've kind of touched base on this one, I think, this morning.
Yeah, I think the one thing we haven't covered on this slide is what should be the focus of the next workshop. Essentially, what do we want to be achieved by the next workshop? And that also feeds into what analyses do we want done before the next workshop, and therefore how much time should be allowed before we plan on having that.
Yeah, and maybe before we do that, are there any go-backs on these? We think we've covered these first three big bullets. Does anyone have anything that they think we missed? And then we'll come. Is that, yeah, right. Can we get a mic, please? Okay, we'll take this, and then we'll come get you.
Don Barker again. I don't know how to couch this one. We seem to, with a lot of the discussions, we say we're going to do resource acquisition, but we gloss over the magnitude of what that really means. I think, if memory serves, less than 5% of all mining operations that have ever occurred on Earth are autonomous or robotic at all. In a perfect 8-hour workday with four crew members, without really understanding what resources we have available, they could be mining 24/7 just to get the resources they need, precluding any, you know, interesting science that they want to do. So I just want to make sure that people keep that in mind. That's a very labor-intensive activity.
That's why we want to have the resource workshops to cover aspects like that. It isn't just how much water is there, it's what are the logistics associated with extracting water from that particular resource. It's a very good point, but again, that's one thing that's become very clear the last 2.5 days. We need that knowledge and we need to work out how to get it.
And I would echo what Ben's saying and add, reminding what Jim Watson was saying last night, easily accessible, which is starting to drive at your point. You know, we don't know that, and hopefully these workshops could help drive that. And these workshops need to be integrated, I mean, in the sense that we get the right communities there so you really knock it out.
The guy from Michigan Tech who knows about difficult
weather. Just a very quick comment on that. The volumes we're talking about compared to terrestrial mining are tiny. All right, so you cannot compare earth mining and what we do here to what we need to do out there. We've done some experiments with small rovers. You know, we're talking 1.5, 1 meter type things that can get remotely controlled the amounts that we need. So we're not talking about something that will take a lot of crew time. We can do this remotely, relatively easy, as long as we understand what it is we're collecting, what composition it has, and what the energy to process takes to do that.
Well, yeah, but I'm going to poke at that because it's more than that. It's, you know, how much energy you've got to throw into it, how much crew ops, and how many times you're sending them out of an airlock. I mean,
we should have a workshop.
Fred Califf, JPL. Real quick on the rubrics, I thought summing the rubrics didn't provide any information. We just need to know whether these geologic points or ISRUs are there. But on the reference EZs, just to clarify my statement, when I said in the center of the science was good everywhere, I thought that all latitude-wise, there were good excellent science EZs at high latitudes, or what we're calling high latitude, up near 50 all the way down to the equator. And I think, but there was obviously a clear bimodal distribution in terms of there's big differences between being up at, 30, 35, 40 latitude versus being at 0, 5, or 10 latitude. And that when you do these reference, when you pick these reference EZs, we can't have them all at the equator. There has to be some ones
that are
at
the... They get a bracket latitude, they get a bracket elevation.
Yeah, yeah. It's very important to do that. I mean, maybe at both latitudes, too.
Yeah,
that's a huge difference.
Yeah. I mean, okay. There might be others, but latitude and elevation are key.
Right, I promised Pan we'd get to her.
Sort of. There we go. Two quick related things. The first thing is, I do think you got the right EZ things there. But one thing that we didn't talk about very much is another axis, which is the temporal one. And we've been assuming a certain amount of time for the exploration. And so we should at least talk about or write about whether or not we have gotten the right amount of time in there for the total mission. That's the first part. The second part is related to that, and that is, we haven't talked a lot about technology, either for the ISRU or for the astronaut-robot relationship. And my question is, if we are using, say, 3 years as a nominal amount of time, 3 Earth years, space qualifying stuff for even equatorial region needs to start right now in order to assume that we could space qualify for the 2X lifetime expectancy. Is there a separate effort going on to do that, or should we be driving that? Or
if you're talking about reliability over time, is that what you're referring to, or just? I guess I'm not following.
So it's more than just reliability over time when we deliver hardware to space qualify it. It's thermal testing, vibrational testing, and all that stuff, and lifetime that is set at either 1.5 times the lifetime or 2 times the lifetime. And this is kind of a different thing because we haven't done these mining technologies yet. So to test them to 2 times the lifetime is a minimum of 6 years, and that means right now it's 2015 and we have no time to waste.
Okay, fair question. And there are a lot of the systems that are associated with the human mission from launching from Earth until getting the crew back to Earth that have those same kind of issues. And we're starting to assemble those kind of timelines to help the management understand what's involved. But we don't have a time that says we're going in this year. So backing up from a notional time is the best we can do right now. And so we're describing that if you want to do X, here's what it looks like to get to X, and that's what we can do right now. Understood that, for the time periods we're talking about, and if it's 5 crews, that could be over a 15-year timeline. So how are we going to make that work? But making it work, understanding that there are going to be people there that can fix things, it's not a one, I let it go and I never touch it again. I can now go back and do something to it, including fixing it or improving it over time. All
if
those
I
have
done. If I were your review board, I would never agree to that. I mean, we want to send robust stuff, and we know we have the humans as an adjunct, but just to say, well, it's okay if it won't last 6 years is dangerous.
Thank you. We won't have you on our review board. My point. Your point is that you need time to test stuff, to qualify it, to launch on a date. We don't have a date, so we can't say that now is the time we need to start testing right things, because we don't have a date that we're working towards, a fixed date that we're working towards. All the points you made are fair points, and the review board would kill us if we tried to come up with a plan that we have now, but we're pre-phase zero minus. We're not there yet. We're starting the process. We're starting the discussion of what we need, and then we can have that discussion of, given where we are now, where do we have to get to, and how long does it take to get there?
Okay, we had a question.
So, Leslie Alexander, NASA. So, in response to your comment, and also with Steve's, that doesn't mean that we're not doing anything right now. In parallel with the efforts that EMC is doing, that this workshop is trying to provide information for, those roadmap activities, those capability assessments that NASA is currently doing, we're looking at timelines, identifying those missions that, you know, we project off to when we might be going to Mars for human and robotic. And we're backing up timelines as to when those CDRs, PDRs, reviews for those missions might be, and then when the instrumentation or instrumentation suites or technology will need to be developed by, looking at readiness levels for capabilities as well as TRLs. And so we're backing up a timeline for development and when those things are needed. That's why I said we've attempted to identify what type of sensors, what type of instrumentation will be needed, what performance parameters are required, and how those address, say, strategic knowledge gaps, things like that. But we do need additional feedback from these communities to make sure that we, you know, we're not just thinking in our own little sandbox.
Okay, and we really need to kind of keep pressing through here. So let's go. So this question right here is really intended to ask inputs on the focus for the next workshop, recognizing we have all these things that we still have to do, and then also a gut feeling, if you will, on when that workshop should be held. You know, that's largely dependent on what are we doing?
So I expanded on that.
Okay. Well, do you want to talk to it since?
No, so we've covered some of these, but, you know, the first order, I think the two critical things are what should be the goal of the next workshop, because that will dictate how, you know, how soon we have it. I mean, one obvious kind of thing that at some point we have to discuss is at what point do we winnow down the number of EZs for further study? Is the next workshop where we start that process? It was very clear from the beginning for this workshop that was not the goal of this workshop. There was no such thing as a bad EZ at this workshop. Maybe the next workshop, and we'd have to define it very carefully, is when we would start to down select, you know, probably still a large number for further study, or we at least start the process of that. So that's one key aspect. I'm not saying we have to discuss this now, but I think this is an important topic, and we would certainly value your feedback over the next 2 weeks on that.
Can we run mics, please?
So for the next workshop, I think actually kind of it's going to go off the linear process of this. But Austin suggested it, that we do a series of potentially talks on everything from orbital traverse analysis, surface traverse analysis, thermal, power, and actually have that information that I've heard a lot of people asking for, kind of present just the quick white paper presentation of here's what you need to know to evaluate it from the operations and the engineering side. And we can have scientists talk about the phyllosilicates and hydrated minerals, and ISRU talk about what's our current state of the art, so we can start bounding these exploration zone proposals based on what we actually know, because not anyone in this room has the complete picture, and I think if we start filling in our personal knowledge gaps, it's going to make for a much better set of proposals.
Yeah. I mean, I think we heard a lot this morning about now that people have done this once, we've started to understand the process. We need to get a lot more information out. People do a lot more homework before the next workshop in order to achieve what I think we need to do at the next workshop.
Yeah,
they're everywhere.
Yeah. Okay, right
there,
here.
There we'll go.
Yeah. David Wilson from NASA Ames. I think the key is water extraction, ISRU, and I think between now and the next workshop, we need to do feasibility studies on extracting from ice or extracting water from soil or from polyhydrated minerals. I think we need to define what's realistic, what's the easiest way, and power, and all those things need to be defined, because we may not be able to go to certain places because of those reasons.
No, I personally agree with you in that if we find that a certain hydrated mineral actually isn't a feasible resource, even though we currently might think it is, that might wipe out whole EZs where that was the only resource. So yeah, I agree. That's another reason for having that resource workshop series, is that I think that it will, that is very, I agree.
So I'd like to add to that. So I think there's like three components that drive a workshop. and I'm not sure that we're totally smart enough about them. One of them, which is what you're describing, which is really guidelines, if you will, that are informed guidelines of, is to help narrow it. Because if we can, if we really feel comfortable from an engineering perspective that something is, should be ruled out, then we should do that so we can free up the amazing talent here to go focus on the area that we're doing, which is kind of your point as well. You know, second thing that's kind of key there is this week you see a whole range of levels of integration on teams. You know, obviously, if a team has ISRU people, you know, the different key science areas represented and or civil engineering on those things, then you start getting a whole different range of solution sets that are there. That integrating teams is actually, it may seem challenging, but that's actually easy. Because, you know, the people are all on this planet, you know, and so I would say it's those kinds of things that we really need to think about. You know, how far can we push these things to actually, you know, make this, to go to the next level? And
So I kind of wanted to follow up on some of the other comments about educating the engineers about science and educating the scientists about engineering. We have a laboratory that's been in orbit around Earth for almost 15 years, and it has a lot of hardware that's, you know, someone was saying about reliability. It has a lot of systems that have been operating continuously or almost continuously for that period of time. I think it's worth it to educate this community, get some of the space station folks in here, some of the systems folks in here to talk about, you know, how the space station operates, some of the problems they've had, because we're going to have the same problems going to Mars, and we can learn from that. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Behind you. Blue shirt one.
Yeah, Austin Nicholas, JPL. So one of the things that I think maybe is almost throwing the question back at you in terms of when should we start down selecting, which was a question that was asked a few iterations ago, is when do you want to have a final landing site actually selected? You know, on the robotic missions, that timeline is something like less than a year before we launch or less than a year before we get there. Is that something that you see also happening on the human in this human endeavor, or do you want it 10 years ahead of time so you can actually design the systems for that landing site rather than designing them for half the planet as we do on the robotic missions?
So I'm not going to answer that now, but I think that's a very good point. I think we'll go away and take that thought on board. That's a very good point.
I think that also, Charles Wetzel, JPL, that also factors into this. There does seem to be a rush here and to down select or get to a single site. Or I think, you know, you've got up there at least the three different front-running styles of ISRU that seem to be manifesting in this workshop, this joint workshop. And I want to reemphasize or add my voice of support to the people that have said there's some more homework to be done. Probably on both sides, but I think a lot of people have said the two communities came together in this workshop not quite on equal footing, right? And the ideas of having an ICEMAG or having additional ISRU workshops that maybe focused on two or three or five different styles of ISRU before we get the two communities back together again, I think that would be the most productive use of the time.
Yeah.
So rather than say a specific point in time, have those prerequisite system analyses or whatever on the ISRU so that the next time the two communities get back together again, they're more on an equal footing.
I'm going to push back on your comment about we have a rush to down select. I mean, I just said very clearly there's no down selection happening at this workshop, and that was just a suggestion. Should there even be that at the second workshop? The answer might well be no. The answer might be the second workshop is this again, but with lessons learned and a lot more work done on the EZs. And then we come up with a pathway. But I know that Steve Clifford, LPI.
Well, I'd like to say something to that too. I would say that we want to do the work. I think these workshops resonate, and in SMD we'd support that strongly. But I think you need to do both. You need to put a target of when the next workshop's going to be, so that it drives it. So when these teams get their work done, otherwise you get into this road that you're never bringing anything to conclusion. You know, and so. You know, I think, again, it's, you know, wherever we can make progress, we ought to be pushing the ball down the field so we're not keeping talking about Mars being 20 years from now, 20 years from now.
I think that a key issue here is when you identify the need for additional data for some of these landing sites, which has been one of the points of this workshop, that you actually allow for the time to acquire that additional data. And in the case of HiRISE and CRISM, we could be talking about a couple of years. On top of that, we've now got the possibility of brand new data sets that are critical to the selection critical to determining the viability of these landing sites that might result from the 2022 orbiter. For example, the identification of near surface ice and water resources with the SAR. It would be, I think, awful if we ruled out landing sites that have the potential for providing tremendous insights into the science, and then find out on the basis of our current lack of identifying a near surface reservoir of water, for example, when the 2022 mission might very well provide that kind of evidence.
So I'm actually glad you brought us back to the data piece. It was actually my third. There's like a tent or a three-prong thing here. There's integrated teams, there's actually guidelines, and there's also what data you can get. It is an intersection of those three that actually drives when you have the next workshop. Because frankly, I could very well see if you had a guidelines and more integrated teams, that might warrant having a next workshop before you even get one shred piece more of data, potentially, because you start to see gains that you can allow you to push it down further. So, I mean, it's really a troika of things that drive it, I think.
Yeah, I think the concern is just the issue about when we do the down select. Right. I think we could have many more very productive workshops in the interim between now and when we do the first down select. So my concern is that we just give enough time before we do a down select from...
Yeah, fair.
So just to follow up on that, I agree with the concern with regard to data, and we just heard today that, you know, you may get your first data set in 12 months, so we're and then you need time to assess that first, you know, new data, so we're probably talking a minimum, Kendall Lynch, Colorado School of Mines, we're probably talking a minimum of like 2 years to the next workshop to give the teams time to get their data and assess it, but I also agree that we don't want to down select then that first one, but at some point we have to do a technology cutoff and we do have to start down selecting, even though we will have all this new data coming in. So we do want to not wait too long and keep carrying 40 plus sites. So, but at some point we do have to start chopping.
Okay. So Jonathan Hill, Arizona State. I think Melissa brought up a really good point earlier about this workshop has mostly relied on work that was done pro bono, short time scales, very little percentage of effort that could go into it. And so I think the next workshop should focus on the result of the work that's done from the AO, so dedicated work, longer term work, so we can dive more into the details of these sites.
Yeah, I was actually going to suggest that the workshop should be tied into the AO directly, saying with a goal of presenting this work X year in your funding cycle or whatever, that it should be part of that funding cycle specifically.
All right, Mike Siebert, JPL. So I'm going to throw something out there that's probably going to get me shunned by a few people.
Join the club.
Yeah. So I've been looking through this, and we've been talking a lot about the ISRU and the ISRU MAV, and I know there are competing Mars descent vehicle designs out there, and the architecture wants us to be Earth-independent eventually. But maybe this first field station shouldn't be dependent on ISRU. If we can't close it in time, do we want to get humans on Mars in the perfect architecture that will never, ever exist by definition? Or can we? Was there a potential way to look at some sites may not be good for ISRU, but they have the most compelling science case, the most productive crew surface field work? And can we potentially consider forsaking ISRU? Because if you're not making propellant out of using water, that cuts your water requirements pretty dramatically, which cuts your resource ROI requirements, which now you're down to a science ROI heavy exploration zone. So I'm just kind of throwing that out there for consideration of a ISRU free EZ.
I would still say that even if the decision is made politically that we can go sooner if we don't do ISRU, I would imagine there was a huge push to still go to the site where we are going to go back to and use the ISRU.
Yeah, and I totally echo what Ben is saying. Actually, I would go to Pan's comment too, where she's talking time scales. You know, so I spent many, many years in the flight control team room here at JSC, and I will tell you, you know, I can't tell you, you know, with toilets breaking and everything else, you know, that you end up worrying about and having backups, you know, you're going to, the value of an EZ really resonates with me strongly, of having a thing where you can start building up sparing. So by definition, if you're, and that might, maybe it's just 2 weeks if they go the first time, or maybe it's, you know, 3 weeks, who knows how long it is, you know, which is getting to Penn's comment, at least what I heard her talk about time scales, you know, but you're still going to the same place and you're still building up infrastructure. And by definition, you can't ignore the ISRU piece. You know, so they have to go hand in hand, even though the knowledge state on ISU, or ISRU particularly, is not very mature.
Does the program collapse if the ISRU equipment fails?
No.
Right. Rob? Let me speak to that, please. This is Rob Mueller, NASA Kennedy Space Center. I'm the lead on the HAT team, Human Spaceflight Architecture team, for ISRU. I want to caution you not to reinvent the wheel here. This has been well studied for 20-plus years. We've had a lot of design reference architectures look at this problem over and over again. We're currently looking at it in the EMC. It's just an engineering problem. You need ISRU for the MAV.
It's,
I think you need to do your homework and look at what's been done before you make those kind of statements. And then this has been peer-reviewed by many, many people over many years. So let's not dive into some assumptions without carefully looking at the literature. And then I think ISRU is baselined by the agency for the MAV. Right now it's oxygen only with atmospheric ISRU. The trade for water is still out there, but it is an active trade. But I think you should very carefully look at the numbers on ISRU, and you will come to your own conclusions. But this work has been done a lot. And so ISRU is needed for a Earth-independent architecture. That's just not open for debate.
So you were right about getting shot.
Yeah, Dave Beatty, Mars Program Office. I'd like to thank you for coming. I'm not sure if Rick is quite ready to wrap up, but get my comments in here.
Okay.
We wrote a paragraph to launch this and put it out as a call for abstracts, and we really appreciate you guys rising to the bait. We recognize that almost everybody here had to donate their time, as is pointed out by Melissa and Bryony and others. Now that you've seen, we've all explored this together for 2.5 days now, what exactly we're talking about, it's perfectly okay to go back and look at your maps again and say, you know, I didn't understand what they were looking for, and the place I proposed wasn't really an optimized place, and I know of another place that's even better. And at the second workshop, I hope there are additional sites that come in. We have 45 sites on the table right now. I wouldn't be at all surprised if another 30 show up there. You know, and maybe some of the sites we have right now, you guys withdraw and say, this really doesn't quite match what I know you guys are now looking for, and here's another place that's better, and let's get that one on the list. But in any case, again, my heartfelt thanks for all of you who contributed. We really, really appreciate it.
Yeah, and I'd like to talk for 1 minute. I also unfortunately have to leave, but I'm sure you're going to carry on the discussions that Rick will lead.
We're going to end at noon sharp, so we promised you that. So.
Yeah, so, but thank you all for coming, and it's been really, really good.
Okay, so let's keep, so, you know, the numbers we've been carrying is like a year and a half out before the next workshop. I'm not hearing, a year and a half might be a better number from what I'm hearing.
Two years.
Yeah, so I think.
It depends on the level of analysis you're going to do. If you want detail, if you have to have an AO in detail analysis, I think we're looking at 2 years. But let's poll the audience and see what they say.
Yeah, well, the point being is, it's a fair year to 2 years, somewhere in that range. But you got to set some goal, and I'm not sure we're even smart enough yet to even pick that yet. Does anyone have any?
I have a comment on that. Well, I think that we've been talking about when the next workshop should be in terms of when we'll be ready to advance the EZ analyses. And I think that's really only one component of what we've done here in this room this week. And the other big component is community building. building collaborations, learning to speak each other's languages. Yeah. And I think that, so I, while I agree with everything that's been said about the timing of our EZ analyses and it should be tied to the funding cycle, it should be, it should allow us to get new data down, and that's really a two-year timeline, I think in order to continue momentum in community building, we need to do something on a much shorter time scale, closer to a one-year thing. Mm. And so we don't... And so we don't have to, we don't have to focus our next workshop on the EZs so much as these other issues we've been talking about education across the communities.
Okay. Any other comments on that?
Yeah, I was actually going to say something similar, which is we may not have time to get more high-rise or CRISM images within a year, but there's definitely other things that we could be talking about in support of this concept that weren't really discussed here. Like, for instance, if the ISRU community wants to talk about how difficult it is to actually extract subsurface ice, that may actually inform better selection of new EZs next time around, looking for something that we weren't looking for this time.
So I would, based off that, the way I would characterize the three things that drive when the next workshop occurs is, and I will change my words, that would be more informed integrated teams, because that's really what we're talking about. So the informed piece is sort of driving that, which is what I'm hearing. You know, secondly, there is the guidance, you know, if, you know, which is, comes out of that informing process. So, for example, if there are regions of the trade space that we can eliminate because we do homework, then we should do that. And then the third piece is data. I'm not even sure you need a whole lot more data yet to actually inform this process, but there's some overlap between all three of those areas that drives when that thing is. And this idea of doing something sooner than later resonates strongly with me. I wish Ben were here. And we also don't want to let the ball drop. We want to keep pushing, you know, to try to figure out what that those options are. Any right here. Can we get a mic over here, please?
Thank you. University of Houston, Olga Banova, Space Architecture. So I have a question related to space architecture. So, for example, for next workshop, are you interested in these teams referring to different surface architectures? Because it can be mission planning. I'm talking about mission architecture. Because it also defines how wide, for example, the site exploration site can be. It can be planned in different ways. It can be one like Marianne's presentation, but it can be planned differently. So it actually can be a larger radius, let's say. It can be different.
So I would say this maybe goes to Pan's. You know, we have to start somewhere. And these guidelines or these the announcement that was there essentially builds in what the Evolvable Mars campaign is. Basically an aggregate of where the agency feels it is, and we have to sort of play to that so we can actually get further down the process. Now, it doesn't mean that if we don't, you know, have a better idea, we don't tweak it. But we need to do. We need to build from a foundation. So I'm not sure.
Yeah, but, there may be some constraints, but again, the how the mission surface mission plans is defines sometimes where the landing sites and its relationship to exploration sites sometimes too, because you can modify. Yeah. So it's
right. But I mean.
But is it? Can it be? Like, what is the
boundary?
Because I know, like, it can be, then it will be all sorts of different architectures, and it will be a mess. You want to have some constraint, give some constraints.
Right. So, but you know,
is it possible to propose some alternatives?
I mean, I would say this. I mean, it is definitely possible to propose it. You know, we need to make sure how to say this. You have an architecture, and you also have steps that you're doing right now and informing a thing. Those things inform each other. In other words, you know, we get data, we run these analyses, and then we have a large picture architecture, and that informs that. That large picture architecture informs what we're trying to do, so that it has to be iterative, you know, to arrive at a robust solution set. So, I mean, if you have ideas, you know, we definitely would like to hear them. But let me go on and see if anyone else. Any others? Yeah, Carol.
Yeah, so what I've been hearing throughout the workshop is, here's my great geology, I don't know anything about biology. Or here's my great geology, I don't know anything about ISRU. And so I think what would really be useful, I mean, workshops are expensive. And I think we all need, and kind of echoing what Melissa Rice was saying, we all need a sort of more interdisciplinary community than we have right now.
Mm-hmm.
And one way to sort of provide some of that training back and forth without a workshop is to actually start a lecture series that could be done online. And I know that the Survey Institute and the Astrobiology Institute both do things like that. SETI Institute even has a lecture series that's performed live at SETI, but it's also online. Mm-hmm. And I think setting something like that up is something that could be done pretty quickly, maybe taking advantages of one of those existing institutes to organize it.
Yeah, and actually I would say we sort of did that for the steering committee members to begin with for the very same reason. So, well, you know, we've got that idea. We'll look at that. Any others? Yeah, Rob.
Rob Mueller, Kennedy Space Center. So, Carol, thank you for that. I'm going to take advantage of that to do a shameless plug for a multidisciplinary event that focuses on ISRU and all the geology and all the different disciplines we've heard about. It's called the ASC, American Society of Civil Engineers Aerospace Division Earth and Space Conference in April 2016, Orlando, Florida. You're all welcome to attend. It's an existing event where this community can just meet, and you don't have to organize anything extra. Just show up at the existing event, and we'll continue this discussion.
Okay. Over here, Dirk.
I think it's critical to keep the momentum going. I mean, we have something, I think, going now, and we cannot allow it to fizzle it out. So my suggestion would have to have the next workshop in less than 2 years. Maybe 1.5 would be good, right about when the new administration takes power, whatever administration that is.
Okay. All right, so we need to, two more comments, and we're going to go to the next slide right here.
And then we'll Lauren Markle, just a real quick question. We have a lot of the interdisciplinary fields here. Do we have something that's associated with the results of all of this, who those people are, who the contacts are, for geology, all the different disciplinaries?
Yeah, so unless anyone has that issue, someone else, several people have already asked about that today. So we're going to go try to make that happen. We understand. I don't think, unless anyone here has an issue with that, I think it's a great thing to do.
One thing I'd like to add as we think about how to move forward is I think we should be also thinking about ways we can involve students in all of these efforts, because even though I still consider myself early career, by the time we see a culmination of this, I'm going to be late career. Mm-hmm. And with the exception of Alex, I think that's the case for many of us in the room. And so as we go forward with each of these steps, let's be thinking about how we can bring in students, how we can support student travel, how we can create internship opportunities to use this as an opportunity to invite more young people into the field.
Yep, that's great. Nope. Okay, and I think, Steve, what else do we need to mention on this page? Yeah. What? Well, you talk it here.
To follow up on that question, I don't know where I'll be in my career by the time this is all done either, but probably not finished. The second bullet is, now that you've all heard this, does anybody have any thoughts on how do we accelerate this process, or is there a way to accelerate this process, or are we in the paradigm of waiting for data to come down, waiting for people to do their analyses, having another workshop, and going step by step that way? Is there anything else that we can do to accelerate that process? Now, maybe some of the workshops that Ben was talking about is one way to do that, having them available online at Khan Academy, if I can borrow that phrase, so that it's available anytime you want, an on-demand kind of a system could be something to help that. But I'd like to hear the thoughts in the room about how do we not only maintain the momentum, but how do we accelerate the process so that we're not waiting for events to occur that are, you know, either beyond our control or that we could accelerate if we just put some effort into it.
And remember that Russian shagza shagam, really, what can we do? That's really the question he's boring in on right now. What else can we do?
So my answer to that, and it's really the first bullet you have there, I personally would appreciate if you didn't make a separate advisory group, because that it doesn't help with the interdisciplinary part, and if we could have maintain the interdisciplinarity of it in whatever you're going to call the group, that would be great.
We had that discussion, and the ICE MAG, whatever it was called earlier, may in fact occur just because that community may need to talk amongst themselves. But we also talked about having something called an easy ag, for example, where we could make sure that I don't know, maybe I made a joke, I don't know, but make sure that the science community, the ISR community, the engineering / ops community are all talking together at the same time, so that we make sure that those interconnections, that we're all aware of those interconnections, and that we take those interconnections into account. So I don't know where that's going. I think that first bullet is probably something that we need to do to make sure that community is taken into account. But there needs to be this integrating thing that sits on top of that, and I'm not sure where that sits or what it's called, but something has to be there to do that.
One thing I think to move the process along is that let's integrate in the places where we do meet, LPSC, International Mars Conference, where we can have maybe special sessions during those regular meetings that we all attend for other reasons, and then we can, get our little bit of the landing site workshop there, or, just what progress have we made, and, we can incrementally bring people together.
Yes.
This is Taishik Lee from Korea again. We are involved in the league program over there, but I definitely support the ISRU/civil engineering. I was president of Korean Society of Civil Engineers, and also I'm the Region 10 governor of American Society of Civil Engineers. Region 10 means world minus America. So I can bring all nations as a civil engineer, so I can put the effort to ICE analysis group. So I support it.
Understand that these MEPAG leagues, SBAG, are associated with the NASA Advisory Council. These are independent assessment groups that are set up to advise NASA. So that it has a special meaning. And how this an ISRU civil engineering one is set up under that construct will have certain steps that will have to be followed, and it has a certain meaning. So it may or may not happen in that regard, but I think it's likely to happen. Let me put it that way. But there still needs to be this overarching thing, and I doubt that is. Well, I don't. My preference would be, my suggestion would be that overarching integrating piece should exist separately from advising the NASA Advisory Council, and it has to be at more of a working level. And that's why I'm saying that I don't know where that exists or how that exists or under whose authority it exists, but something like that needs to happen so we continue to make these connections and the interactions available or aware to all the different groups.
What else? If you or Chris, we'll go to Chris Carver back there, and then we'll Pascal, go ahead while he's getting the mic.
Okay, so just a quick point. So there's good news and bad news on what I'm going to say. The good news is we actually have a bit of funding to go to Devon Island again this coming summer. That's July, August. It's going to be our 20th consecutive field campaign, so there's some consistency there. I'm not presuming what NASA would want to do on Devon or not, but the point is, on Devon we have rock glaciers, ground ice, RSLs, and sulfates, polyhydrated sulfates. And going to Devon, as opposed to Antarctica, for example, is about an order of magnitude more affordable. So I just wanted to plant the seed, if there's interest in this community and beyond you to somehow do something, either get samples or run a field experiment that could inform this whole process, not necessarily next summer, incidentally, maybe 2 years from now, whatever. Feel free to contact me, and if there's enough interest, I'll relay that to this group.
Okay, thanks. Chris.
Yes, it was mentioned earlier, kind of for the sake of keeping up momentum, keeping the discussion going, utilizing other conferences that we all go to. I want to suggest possibly, like we Explore Mars runs run. We're happy to humans to Mars summit. We're happy to offer space. If there's some side discussion, something to keep the process going, we can integrate it into the main program or whatever. We're happy to provide the resources, provide the space. You know, if there's something people want to do, if there's a particular area, this is in May 17th through 19th in Washington, but if there's something this year, or rather 2016, you think you might want to start discussing, start pushing something forward, we're happy to provide the space, the resources, and even integrate it in the program if there's something to talk about it publicly also.
Okay, cool. Thank you. All right. Can we get a then we'll take two more questions and we'll stop for the day.
Laura Kerber, JPL. I wanted to talk about the, we were talking about the pacing and, you know, how we keep moving the ball down the field. And I think sometimes what happens, everyone always wants to go to Mars and then something happens, like the president says something or the Congress does something, and then we kind of get thrown off course a little bit, and then we have to regroup and come back later. And I really think if we can keep moving, kind of regardless of the climate is, keep moving forward to the point where we have a really solid, excellent plan that all of these people in this room can agree on, because we're not really their top priority. And so if we come looking to them for both money and direction, I think it'd be better to say, you know what, if you give me your support, we have something already really well planned out that will change the history of civilization and will go down in the history books forever, and we just need some money and we'll do it, you know. I think that's like a goal that our community should reach for.
So maybe that's a good place to stop. So, you know, I'll have to chime in one word. Just for, what? Yeah, Alex. Well, go ahead, Alex.
Yeah. Alex Lunar of the Cardinal Gibbons High School. I would like to sort of tag off what Melissa said, and maybe we should find some ways to make this high-rise and Chrism data more available to the public, put on that new Mars Quest program or something. Mm-hmm. And also maybe find some way to get students' opinions on landing sites, because really they're the Mars generation. It's our duty to help them and see what they want in what place we should go on Mars. And second, I would just like to say thank you to everyone who supported me and let me come here and who's in favor of this great mission.
Yeah, cool. So, and I am going to come back to Laura's point, which is that specifically, you know, if you look at before I did aerospace engineering, I was a history major, and I actually my thesis was actually on frontier histories, and I will tell you the grand sweep of frontier exploration has always been largely self-advocated by the people doing it, and what I would say to your point is that, you know, having a plan that's vetted and tight and affordable and sustainable is 8/10 of the battle, and you may not get one administration supporting it, but if you keep pushing it hard, it will happen eventually. And so this process, as murky as it is right now, is about doing that. And so I will tell you, it's been a real privilege for all of us on the steering committee to work with you all this week, and we are looking forward to continuing to do that and start building that plan. So thank you. Oh, Jim was wanting to see you. No, I'm done. I've said my piece.
Well, I didn't mean to interrupt.
Yeah, I didn't mean to interrupt, but indeed, what I'd like to do specifically is thank the steering committee and all the hard work they did to organize the workshop. They did a tremendous job. And of course, as you can see, it's really just the start. You know, we've got so many wonderful inputs that have occurred over the last several days to take in and continue on. It is indeed our intent to stay the course. It is indeed our intent to have humans on Mars. It is indeed our intent to do these things that we've charted this course today. That's what makes this meeting a historic one, in my opinion, and one that we're going to look back on as a turning point in our move to Mars. You know, we've been talking about going to Mars forever, it seems like, and it's always 30 years off. But I think technology-wise, what we know about Mars, we've really turned the corner. And it's now time for us to really get busy and make that vision happen. And one of the things I liked about The Martian, you know, science fiction is an important part of our culture, is that it allows us to dream. It allows us now to fulfill that dream. And so Alex will be our first Martian. No, we won't leave him on Mars. We won't leave him on Mars. But so thanks again for everyone that really worked so hard to make this successful and really work hard on getting your sites forward. And our dedication now is to band together to pull this off. Thank you.
Thanks, everyone. Okay, and we want to thank everybody out in the Ustream audience, too, for your participation, and we need your ideas, too, so thanks for joining us this week. Thank you.